guys ready? All right, it's time to go ahead and get started this morning. The teens have devotion.
Thank you.
Good morning, good morning. Good to be here. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Good to be with my brothers and sisters in Christ here today to learn God's word and come to worship God in his house. And just a blessing it is to get to come and to help these young adults learn God's word. And it's just a blessing in my heart to see young folks that want to learn the word of God, that are trying to learn the word of God. And I just think of all the things that people who aren't in families that want to take their kids to church could be doing today. But instead, these kids are here and they are learning God's word. And so we have just been studying the Gospel of Luke. With the idea of just trying to get our minds around some of the history and the context and everything that was going on. And so we're in the third chapter today. We studied three men, Annas and Caiaphas, the high priests at the time, and John the Baptist. And we just kind of compared and contrast their lives and how Annas and Caiaphas were so rich and so powerful, but they served money and they served the Romans and political power, and how John the Baptist was so poor and just didn't have any good clothes and didn't have any good food, but he had the word of God which had come unto him and how powerful that was. And so we just kind of compared and contrasted them, and we just talked about true spirituality and spiritual pride, and then we found some scriptures in the Bible that we can read and learn about spiritual pride and true religion, which these fine young folks are going to read for you now.
No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon.
Proverbs 16:18 through 20. Pride goeth before destruction, and an haughty spirit before a fall. Better it is to be of an humble spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud. He that handleth a matter wisely shall find good, and whoso trusteth in the Lord, happy is he.
Matthew 5:3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Good job. Let's give him a hand.
Good job, man.
Thank y'all. We'll go ahead and turn the service over to Brother Jeff at this time.
We'll go ahead and get started this morning. Good to see everyone. Sure did enjoy yesterday. Some fantastic food and fellowship and unbelievable turnout and help from the church. So we'll start with our first announcement with our coordinator for the fundraiser was Caleb Osborne.
I would not say I'm the coordinator, but I just kind of had to
ticket tracker, I guess you could say, would be the best thing to do. But y'all did an unbelievable job. Everyone that showed out, showed up. I know everyone had a hand in it, whether just getting the cookers here or the men that cooked here, prepping. There's a lot of prep work that got done. The slaw, the chicken. Some of y'all know the chicken. There's some people did a lot to make sure that we had plenty of plates. And y'all did an amazing job. And not only that, just the people that sold tickets. We had 282 of the 300 plates sold. So especially when you're doing something like this, just to go in knowing that, hey, all we have to do is prep it and worry about it. We don't have to really worry about anybody coming by and having to advertise. We didn't even advertise at all, I don't believe. It's just by word of mouth and everything. So y'all did a great job. I just want to give y'all a round of applause. Thank y'all so much. So I guess what you really want to know is how much did we make? So how much did we raise? So we right now with the donations and the plates sold, $5,025. So that was a great job, y'all. Y'all did an awesome job. And thank y'all for all y'all's hard work.
And I feel sorry for any of you that did miss the preparation. I got to see chicken killed twice by our preacher. I'd never seen chicken beat with an iron skillet before. But I tell you what, it works. It was some of the best chicken I've ever eaten. So with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Brother Gerald for some other announcements.
I'll make a few announcements. It sure was a good day yesterday, and it's amazing what we can all do when we pull together, especially working for the Lord in a good cause. Made me some notes this time where I wouldn't forget. We're going to have a baby shower for Mason and Sarah Pierce on Saturday the 14th at 1 from 11 to 1. Everybody's invited. Also, the men will be cooking breakfast on the morning of the 15th for the graduates. What time do we want to do that?
Is usually during the Sunday school hour. From 10 or 9:30. Ladies, what do you think?
I put 9 on the calendar.
9.
Okay.
All and right. Then there won't be Sunday school that day. That's May the 15th.
Okay.
And
start at serve at
9. All righty.
Okay. There.
The 15th. 15th of this month?
Yes.
Okay. Do you want me to mention the ones I know that are graduating?
Yeah, please.
Okay. So, this year we have Nathan Green that's graduating from the University of Georgia. That's Carolyn and Durla's grandson. We have Olivia Sullins, and she's graduating from high school in Germany. But Olivia will be going to North Georgia College this year. We have Ethan Pierce graduating from North Georgia College. We have Kelsey Marshall graduating from Lumpkin County High School, and Jesse Fouts graduating from Lumpkin County High School. Have I missed anyone?
Mm-hmm.
So three college graduates and two high school graduates this year. So don't miss that. It's an important day for them, and they're very excited. And we will have breakfast, and if you want to bring anything for them, they'll have a little basket and a table set up for each child.
That'd be great. Proud of these people accomplishing all these goals and heading out into the workforce in life. It'd be great. Remember all those that are sick and suffering. Remember Mr. Owen and Miss Mary, they're still shut in, and Mark and Mary, just continue to remember them, and Denise and Juan, and is any others that are sick that we need to have prayer requests for? If not, let's remember them and hold them up, and the ones that take care of the caretakers. Really need a lot of encouragement, and we appreciate that and all that they do.
Holman, their son Keith has been diagnosed with cancer, and he's going through treatments, and it's pretty advanced. And then Amanda was diagnosed last week or week before last with breast cancer. So pray for that family, please.
Continue to remember my friend Dan Ring. He came up with his wife yesterday to get a plate and asked if they could come into the church, and just said what a beautiful church it was, and I'm hoping they're going to start coming, but he's got stage 4 It started in his prostate, and it's in his bones. He'll start it. He meets with his chemotherapist next week and see which way they go, but not looking real good for him. So remember that, family. Jerry, you had one more.
Yeah, my mind's about as long as my hair, and sometimes it's getting real short. We want to, all the pledges that have been pledged for the paving of the parking lot, we would like to have them in by the 15th. And that way we can see where we're at and what we got and which way to go from there. But that'll be on the 15th.
Anyone else have any announcements? Hold on a second.
No, I'd just like to say that I've asked several of you that's bought stuff for yesterday for the meal. I don't know everything that was spent. Everybody I've asked said they were going to do a donation. So if y'all have spent something, I don't know it. If I need to reimburse somebody from a church, well, please let me know. Don't want to leave anybody out. But if you'll let me know if you do. If not, then I guess it's a donation. But thank y'all.
Thank you, Jerry, for taking care of the financial well-being of the church. Anyone else? Yes.
Miss Gail was nice enough to type up a calendar for May. It's on the front bench. So if you want a church calendar, it's on the front bench right up front. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? All good things this morning.
I think Jennifer had good news. She needs to, I think Jennifer had good news. Her thing came back good.
So. No. Hold your horses. I got my running boots on this morning.
I got my test results back Thursday. It was all clear, thank the Lord. And I was telling the preacher and his wife yesterday how I knew it was going to be good. I had asked him every day to just give me a sign that everything was going to be okay. Well, Thursday morning, I go through Dairy Queen every morning before I go to work. And I went up and I get a sausage biscuit and I have my 237 ready and I went up to pay for it and the guy in front of me paid for it. So I automatically called Todd and I said I finally got my answer. And then Thursday afternoon I got my call that it was clear. So, I mean, just wait on him. He will show you if you ask him. So thank y'all very much for praying for me. I love y'all.
If everyone will please stand, we'll worship with our offering. I'm sorry. Oh, okay, yes, I forgot birthdays. I got a little tore up back there. That's great news, Jennifer. Any birthdays this week? Audrey.
She's 14.
She's, oh, yeah, okay, here we go. 14. Anyone else?
Michael had a birthday.
Okay. Remember, we'll get you next week, Michael, okay? All right, buddy. Let's sing Happy Birthday. Very good. Now we'll worship with our offering. We ask Bert and Benny if they'd come take up the offering this morning. We'll ask Carolyn to bless the offering this morning.
Dear Lord, we want to thank you for the opportunity to be back in your wonderful house today, God. First of all, I want to thank you for all you've done for me and my family and the blessings you've given us. Thank you, God, for our church and what it means to us. Thank you, God, for the wonderful day we had yesterday, the wonderful fellowship. It was such a joy just to be together yesterday and work for you. And, Lord, I just pray that you would forgive me and for all the things I do that's wrong. And, God, that you would just use us to serve you and to follow your will. Lord, I pray for the sick this morning. I pray for the ones that's lost. God, if there be someone here that's lost, please, Lord, just give them a chance. And, God, I thank you again for the many blessings of life you've given me. I thank you for our leaders of our church. Thank you for Ricky and Ree and what they mean to us, God. And I pray a special blessing on them today. And God, I pray for Jeff, the wonderful job he does, and And God, I'm just so blessed and so happy to be here. And I thank you, God, for everything. I just can't thank you enough. And I don't even know what all to ask for. There's so many things that you've blessed us with. But God, I pray you'd be in our service today, God, and that we'd be able to just lift you up and praise, God. And once again, Lord, let us be the best we can be for you, because we love you, Lord. In thy precious name of Jesus, I ask all this. Amen.
Thank you. 408.
Safely through the
some sweet day when I walk up that great Milky Way. Good morning, Lord. Good morning there before the throne. What a singing there will be when I get home. When I move up there to settle down, when I step inside the gate to look around, I'll need at least a million years to view the throne. So many friends I long to see when I get home. Oh Lord, please hear my prayer before I leave. May I live so my friends can follow me. The little ones you gave to me while here below, I want to meet each one of them when I get home. Yes, I'll reach home, oh praise the Lord, some sweet day when I walk up that great Milky Way. Good morning, world. Good morning there before the throne. What a singing there will be when we get home.
Amen. We appreciate that. Amen. Good to see everyone in the house of the Lord. I'm glad you came this morning. Appreciate that wonderful spirit and those testimonies. I tell you what, now what we need is somebody get saved here this morning. That'll just about be it. But then there'll be a little shouting going on. I tell you, I'm looking forward to it, don't you? Did you think the Lord saved somebody this morning? Why, amen. I believe he can. Church begins to work like it is, and let the Lord lead us in our lives, and he just so great. And I've been kind of sitting on that bench and crying a little bit. You know, the Lord just too good to me. And you know, I just think about people that don't know him and how he'd like to bless them like he's blessed me. I'm telling you, I just want you to get acquainted with him. I mean, he's so great. When I was 15 years old, I got saved, and he's been with me ever since. And then he put this woman in my life that I do not deserve. On May the 1st, 1976, Marita was married. It's been 46 years. And babe, I can't give you the material things you deserve, but I'm giving you everything, the love, all the compassion, this woman has been so good to me in my life. People talk about marrying up, all that stuff. I wouldn't be on marrying up. I'm telling you what, my friends, I think of things we've been through. We've been talking about it this morning a little bit, and I am just so thankful the Lord put her in my life. I'm telling you what, she's been through the thick and the thin. We've been the privilege to be at three other churches, and I tell every church the same thing, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. I'm the least pastor you'll ever have, but you don't have the least pastor wife you've ever had. I'm telling you that. She's always been a rock to me and to every church that we've been in. And you folks know her by now, and you know that's true. So, Rhea, I thank you from the bottom of my heart for the Lord putting you in my life. If you haven't counted your blessings lately with your companion, I want you to do it. And we know it's some of you that the Lord's called home, and we know that's got to be hard, or we imagine, I don't know. But I want everybody to count your blessings while you have them. And it won't be long, folks, we're all going to be together. I'm telling you what, this thing's just about wrapped up. The Lord's just about, our Father's just about ready to look over to the Son and say, go get my children. And I'm telling you what, my friends, I believe it's that close. I don't know of nothing in the book to prevent it from coming today. And I hope you're just ready for it. I really do. I want you to know, once you those skies, the eastern skies break open, it's over. Don't you be thinking I'll get saved when he comes. It's over. I want you to get saved when he asks you. And you'll know that. You really will. And I hope that you're not spurred that opportunity. You have your Bibles turned with us now in Matthew 12. Start looking at verse 43. Matthew 12:43. You pray for us. Matthew 12:43. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places and seeketh rest and findeth none. Then he saith, I will return into my house from which I have came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty and swept and garnished. I want you to hear that. Then cometh he and taketh with him seven other spirits, more wicked than himself, and they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. Heavenly Father, we ask for your blessings on your word. I ask for the anointing of our calling and not another. I pray if there be one lost, Lord, and you spoke to their heart, they'll realize what a privilege it is for you to invite them into the family of God. I pray that the church will be praying. And Lord, if anybody's drifted away, this will be the great day in their life. They'll come back home. And all that you do, we're going to give you the glory in Christ's name. Amen. You pray for us that we'll only say that the Lord bids. And we know that you read your Bibles, you understand this, you know. The Lord, last week we went to our funeral, and I want you to remember the family and all. And we were some of the family was sharing with me, it's Kelly family, sharing with me his testimony. And I know Ron, acquainted with him and all. And he was saying, they said that his whole family was always at Yellow Creek, and that's where he was saved and baptized, so he thought. And as he got older, he married, and they ended up going on down to the south side of, I guess, like South Hall. And he joined the church there. And they sent for the letter at Yellow Creek, and they couldn't find his membership at Yellow Creek. They had no record of him being baptized of being a part of that church. And so they got to digging a little bit more, and it kind of strung out. And then one Sunday morning, they said Ron came up when the preacher gave the invitation. And he bowed down and asked the Lord Jesus Christ to be his Savior. He said the reason it wasn't was for a purpose, because he didn't really ask the Lord to save him. He just kind of went through that pretense at Yellow Tree. And his letter helped him to check up, and he never was saved. And he got saved and joined that church and got baptized. Now, friend, I want to tell you, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ, you ought to know when it happened. And it has to be the greatest thing in your life. Now, it does. I've had many great things. I've shared with you my wife, my children, as y'all could, and brag on them, and you should. Amen. Brag on your family. Hug them, you know, way, you know. But our friends, when the Lord saved you, it ought to have been the greatest thing. You ought to be able to go back to it, and keep on going back to it. Now, the devil's put doubt in my heart and my mind. He can do that. He's great at trying to confuse us, my friends. And I don't want to confuse nobody. If the Lord saved you, I know, my friends, the Bible says we can get away from the Lord, that we've forgot we ever been purged from old sin, but he won't save you twice. You may have to ask for forgiveness, and my friends, and ask him to come back and let him get that light going better. It never does go out. It just kind of gets foggy at times, but if the Lord saved you, it's for eternity. I preach it. I believe it. I'm glad the Lord's got me and I don't have the Lord. I'm telling you what, I'd lose it. I'm sure I would have lost it by now. I lose everything else, it seems like, down here. But I tell you, what the Lord has done in my life, he's came in. And that's what I want you to see in the scripture here. So the Lord got to stirring about the house. And we have many places. I remember Joshua said it so well. After the children of Israel came out of Egypt and divided up the lands, and everybody, every family had their portion. He says, now as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord, my friends. Now, we all want to raise our children to know the Lord and respect the Lord and show that. But you can't make your companion, you can't make your children serve the Lord. You can set an example before them. I'd love to preach it and let the Lord give it to me. The difference, my friend, between Noah and Lot was how they, the life they lived. If Lot, well, I'll just share it with you for a moment. If Noah hadn't lived a life righteous and before God and right when he told his boys to get in the ark, they would have done just like this world's doing. Listen, I want you to get in the ark of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to know him as a Savior and have him in your heart, my friends. And the only reason them boys, they was married, got in that boat, never had rain before, but the reason they did is because the example of their father. Let me encourage the fathers and grandfathers to set an example. And when you make a mistake, you realize you're human and say you're sorry and make it good with your family, amen, that they'll have confidence in you. Noah's boys had confidence. I don't know, it ain't ever rained, but he built this boat and I'm going to get in, amen. Lot, as Brother Trey had preached not long, just the other day, they laughed him because of how he lived his life. The Bible said Lot, he had vexed his righteous soul by sitting at the gates of Sodom and Gomorrah. You can't be in sin and expect people to have respect for you, friend, and claim to be a Christian. Now, it ain't none of us perfect, but we need to work and shoot for that. Amen. We need to know it's what's right, and they'll say, well, that's a little gray. Not with God, it ain't. It's either right or wrong. It's either sin or not. There isn't no gray areas with God. Amen, that's exactly right. We get away from the Lord. And the other thing he said, I change it not. He didn't say in 2022 when America got so, they thought they were so great, my friend, I'll change. He says, I'm same today, tomorrow, and change it not. Amen, he's the same God. And he wants us to realize that. I'm telling you, my friends, I want you to think about your house. I really do. Hezekiah, the whole man of God, had to go up in front of the king. He says, set your house in order. You're going to die, my friend. I want to tell you, each and every one, if my Lord don't come back, you're going to die. Amen. I want you to know you need to set your house in order. I'm not talking about a building. I'm talking about in your heart, my friends, with your soul. You need to get it in order and to know where you'll be if the Lord was to call you home today. So many times we think, I got plenty of time. Let me tell you, I guarantee you, if we went out and done a survey that cemetery, we could find every age from just a baby on up to close to 100. No doubt your age is out there. I don't know when you're going. I don't know when I'm going, but I want you to be ready. So set your house in order. Quit putting it off. Amen. I'm glad old Hezekiah looked to the wall and prayed. He didn't say, I'm great king. He repented. The Bible said he shed some tears, and the Lord said, I've seen his tears, I heard his cries, and I'm going to add to him 15 years. We never know how long any of us got, my friends, but while we're here, let us realize there's a purpose in our life. And my friends, let us be accounted a joy to go for the Lord. My friends, I know that there's houses, and we thank you, my friends, of things how the Lord said. He says, in my house shall we call the house of prayer, and meaning this structure here. My friend, here was a time the Lord was using this parable to let people understand that there'll come a time, my friends, and our children, and I'm glad we teach it and we preach it here at Mount Olive. There'll come a time, my friend, your light's going to go out. There'll come a time, my friends, that the Lord is not going to be there because he wants you to realize your house is empty. The Bible says that his house, there's so many people have done the wrong thing. I want to hear to tell you today that my friend, that Judas Iscariot would have went to the cross and he threw the 30 pieces of silver at the foot of my cross of my Lord while he hung there. I'm telling you, with all the compassion my God, my Lord had, he'd have forgiven Judas Iscariot, and he'll forgive you for what you've done in your life. Realizing, my friend, you're in the presence of him. He loves everybody that much. But the Bible said he didn't. He went out and hung himself. And the Bible said that Judas Iscariot, my friend, would have been better if he'd never been born. I want you to set your house in order this morning. I want you to realize what happened in this scripture was somebody come to what we call the age of accountability. Somebody come to what we thought, my friends, they said, I want to change. You know, a lot of times people get, I'm going to do better. This old devil is good at what he's done. He's lured people away. They've done things that they would never thought they would have done. He's good at what he does. And they get to do better, you see. And they'll think, well, I'm just going to do better. Well, your do better is not going to get you to heaven because of the blood of Christ was hung on Calvary for you, my friend. It takes him to get you to heaven. And I want you to know your house is empty. And these Bible said these devils went out, and my friends, and they wandered around, and they couldn't find the place. And they said, I know what I'll do. I'll go back to where I was. And the Bible says, you read that script, the first thing they found, that the house was empty. The second thing they found, it was garnished and clean. That means they had to do better. They was getting ready for the Lord to save them. But what they didn't do, they didn't invite the Lord Jesus Christ. And the reason you don't have the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart and your house is empty, because you didn't invite him in, amen. That's all he's wanting is an invitation. You see if he don't come in if you give him the invitation. You see if you'll ask for him to save you if you don't save. I promise you, you in the world out there, if you'll give my Lord a chance and humble your heart and ask him to come in, you see what he done. See, this person felt better and all. He got to do betters. And I want to encourage people to do better. But I'm telling you, the devil's too great for you to do it on your own. It won't be long, you'll slip up. It won't be long, he'll catch you at a bad time. You'll get to be feeling, you know, we all have our ups and downs. We have things when they go right and when they don't. And all of a sudden, he'll be there. But when you have the Lord Jesus Christ in your house, you see, and he abides in your house. And when that old devil comes a-knocking, my friend, he finds that it's not only garnished and swept, he finds it's not empty, for the Lord's there, amen. Listen, we need to realize that we're no match for the devil, but he that is in me is greater than he's in the world. I'm telling you, he's got nothing on my Lord. He's been through it all with it. He's felt the pain. There ain't nothing he can't handle. And that's the reason the devil knows. And when he went over there to Gethsemane and the devil was there, and that man came and throwed himself out, and they began to talk. They realized they was in the presence of greatness. I'm telling you, if your house is swept, my friends, and garnished and empty, you're not saved. If you haven't invited the Lord into your house, and you should have known when it happened. Because he went home with you, you see. When you thought something you shouldn't, all of a sudden, he condemned you. It wasn't because a preacher saw you. It wasn't because mom and dad saw you. It's because the Lord saw you. He says, you're one of mine. You don't act like that no more. You're one of mine. You don't talk like that no more. Well, I got mad. I couldn't help it. No, that don't work with the Lord. You may say, well, they do that. No, that just don't work with the Lord. See, he condemns you and you feel bad. And you know what happens when the devil comes back to you again and wants you to say something that's not right? Because he condemned you. You remember that. I'm not going to go on that route. I always said David never went back on top of another house. He wasn't perfect, my friend, but he never went back. Listen, when the Lord teaches you something, he'll teach you right. Because he's in your house, you see. I'm glad he don't leave us, aren't you? I'm glad I don't have him only on Sunday morning. I'm proud we come here to worship. And Lord, those testimonies, those songs, bless my heart and my friends. And we need to have these blessings to make us strong, just to feel his presence, my friend. And I'm glad he goes with me on Monday and Tuesday. I'm telling you, on Wednesday, they call it hump day. I'm telling you, the Lord don't need no hump. If we stay where we're at, we'll be strong on Wednesday. I'm telling you, we may come and get another charge. Amen. I want us to be ready for the Lord. But if your house is empty, it's just a matter of time before the devil comes. And he gets you mad at somebody. The preacher didn't do something. Somebody else of the church didn't do something. So I'm not going to church. Oh, my friends, let me beg you, always find yourself in the house of the Lord. They ain't none of us perfect. We've all had our things that we wish we could have done better. But we just keep on coming. The prayer we teach our children, if we ain't careful, we don't think about it. Lord, forgive us of our sins and trespasses. If we forgive those who trespass against us, we want to leave that part out, don't we? We want to say, yeah, now I want them to pay, but it's all right for me. God wants us to realize he loves us. He abides with us. He's in my house. He's in many of your houses because I know your testimony, your spirit, but there's somebody that the house is empty. And oh, I want you to get saved this morning. I really do. I want you to realize what is a privilege. And I want you to realize that you're turning the Lord away. And you say, well, I'm young. It don't matter if you're young or if you're old. And there may be somebody like Ron was a grown man and had a family. But he just went through the pretenses of it. There's a lot of people in our world today that have went through the pretenses of knowing Christ. And I'm telling you, my friends, it will not work. There's too many empty houses in our churches. I want you to search your heart, to know you're saved. Don't be under a shadow of doubt, because my friend, it's that important. It's that real. And it ought to be that real to you. Yes, my friends, the Bible said this man repented. He swept and he cleaned his house, but he never invited the Lord in. I want you to know the Lord wants to set you straight. He wants to put your feet upon the rock. I think of what Peter said so well when they say, and I ask you the question this morning, when Brother Jeff comes with a song, who do men say that I am? Some say Elias and some a prophet. But he looked at him, but he said, who do you say that I am? Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, blessed art thou, Bar-Jonas. See, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. I want you to know it ought to be that real in your life. Flesh and blood has not, but my Father, which is in heaven. And I want you to know when you get saved, he comes in abide. Is your house empty? And would you like him to come in? My friends, what you got to do is ask. If you'll ask, I promise you, he'll come in. While we stand and sing, what's your number, Brother Jeff?